Good morning and welcome to the 24th meeting of 2024 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. I've received apologies from Michelle Thompson this morning, and Bob Doris is attending as a committee substitute. We'll also be joined by Colin Smith, who's attending online. So our first item of business is a decision to take item 4 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our next item is an evidence session with the Scottish National Investment Bank and Scottish Enterprise. The main purpose of this session is to inform the committee's pre-budget consideration. I welcome Al Denham, Chief Executive Officer, and Michael Robertson, Chief Financial Officer at the Scottish National Investment Bank, and Adrian Gillespie, Chief Executive, and Douglas Colquhoun, Chief Financial Officer, Scottish Enterprise. If I ask members and witnesses to keep their answers as precise and concise as possible, that would be helpful. If I can maybe come to an opening question, we're looking at the budget for the upcoming year. We've also had in-budget adjustments made in this year. We are facing a difficult financial situation. Now, I think if you maybe want to briefly say what the priorities are, but focus more on what the challenges are and what the risks are to delivery to those priorities, given the financial situation that we find ourselves facing. If we come to the Scottish National Investment Bank first.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, convener and the committee. And thank you for the opportunity to speak to you on this. And clearly, the budget challenges are something that we're all facing. If I could give some context for why this is an important topic. As an institution, we're 3.5 years old, and we are moving from what we call the startup phase into becoming an established player in the Scottish ecosystem, the financial ecosystem, delivering real impact in line with our business plans and with our missions that were set by the Parliament. As you recall, we make investments in businesses and projects that benefit Scotland, aligned to the three missions that were set for us when we were established. These are Scotland's journey to net zero, harnessing and encouraging innovation, and improving places and communities. So in the 3.5 years since we've been established, we have committed £650 million of the £2 billion that was committed to us when we were first set up. Roughly, if you imagine, that's about £200 million per annum, to support 37 businesses and projects across the length and breadth of Scotland. And critically, in doing so, we've also crowded in over £1.4 billion of private sector support at the same time. And one of the key things that we do when we are making an investment is we seek to crowd in a good crowding in ratio as part of our process. So these short-term performance indicators, I think, are encouraging and moving in the right direction, and I think are aligned with the vision of for the bank when we were set up. But what we need to do is we need to continue on that path, and I think that's why this budget discussion is very important. What I'd also like to do is make the point is we are making real investments on behalf of the people of Scotland that are delivering good quality long-term investments, creating jobs, reducing emissions, and so on, in line with our emissions. We have a full pipeline at this stage of the financial year, and are making strong investments to new businesses and projects, and also supporting existing investees. However, as the committee will be aware by the question, a reduced budget settlement for this year has restricted our ability to be able to invest as much as we would like. We've had to be more selective in what we're doing. So in the course of this morning, I'm sure we'll discuss some of those investments. But one of the things I'd like to draw attention to give you a sense of what we have been doing, one deal that demonstrates what we can do, is earlier this year, we committed £50 million to the Argosy Airport just outside Inverness. The investment will help re-energise a decommissioned oil and gas fabrication yard. And with new life breathed into the site, at full capacity, it's estimated the potential there is to enable around 3,000 jobs in the local area.
Will the budget that we're facing slow down the pace that you've described that Scottish National Investment
Bank is working at? Absolutely will slow it down. Yeah. Absolutely, and that's the point I'm trying to make, hopefully, as you hear from my comments. And by the point about that investment, it will also act as a catalyst to other investments. Mm-hmm. So you'll start seeing additional employers coming into the area because that investment de-risks their investment decisions. You'll start seeing more housing being developed in the area to support those workers. If you've got 3,000 workers and you've got a shortage of housing, so it's a ripple effect, mm-hmm. Which is not just seen as the one headline number of 50 million. In doing that deal, that investment, sorry, I talk deal, that's terminology, in doing that investment, we crowded in £350 million of third-party capital or other capital into that deal. Mm-hmm. And that deal would not have happened without our convening and our work there. So I give that as an example of the kind of things we can do and the kind of things that might be threatened if budgets are threatened. Mm-hmm. And clearly I could make other examples across all of our missions.
Mm-hmm. So because we're a bit pressed for time this morning, mm-hmm. and before we want Scottish Enterprise, just looking a bit further forward, you'll know that the ScotWind revenue, the £450 million, is looking to be used to possibly support resource funding, resource spending in this coming year. You have previously commented as a body the importance of the ScotWind and the opportunities it presents for a renewable investment. Do you have any comment on the government's announcement of the use of the remaining £460 million that came from ScotWind?
So if I think about ScotWind as a whole, I think it's a really important strategic initiative, and we are seeing through the work that we are doing, we have had an investment team in our area who are focused on ScotWind, we're seeing significant, much greater than, you know, close to multiple billions of pounds of opportunities of funding requests that will ultimately come our way. We're working with the offshore wind investment pipeline work group to support that. What we're also doing is making sure that we are making the point that if we invest commercially first with our commercial mindset, that will be generate the best value for the Scottish taxpayer. However, in many of these deals, there is a need for some grant funding and concessionary funding as well, and we've noticed that in the deals. What we also think is if we structure these deals as commercial deals or commercial opportunities that appeal to private sector, you will then get private sector coming alongside as well. Mm-hmm. So it's very important to get the structuring right.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. If I may move on to Scottish Enterprise, so there's two similar questions. It is the budget, challenging budget settlement we have in this year, and looking to the next year, what the risks there are in terms of delivery, and what the impact of the ScotWind announcement that will be used for, likely to be used for resource funding rather than investment, what impact that will have.
Thank you. Good morning, convening, morning everyone. So I think it's quite important to break that challenge down into the various budgets, given the different uses of the capital budget, the resource budget, the financial transactions budget, which is under real pressure. Last year, I talked about having to refocus, having to focus on transformative opportunities. We've taken that stage further this year by, like the Scottish National Investment Bank, focusing on three missions, delivering the energy transition, scaling up fantastic innovation that exists around the country, and also facing into this productivity challenge that we have, and the potential to leverage in far more significant levels of capital investment to address that challenge. I think, is showing success in the results. We've gone on to even greater levels of achievement last year in terms of our impact, record levels of job creation, very significantly record levels of capital investment. So I think that impact is starting to show through, but there are challenges in the budget situation. The challenges have driven us to focus on more transformative opportunities, and I think that's reflected in our results. But over the last 5 years, we've delivered 80,000 jobs impact when you look at the wider impact on the economy, and that's a return of £25 GVA for every £1 we've invested. So I think that what that shows is that we're delivering really good results with the resources that we have, but it does show that we could go further if we had even more resources at our disposal. Capital budget, we were actually quite pleased given the situation that we were in with the capital budget that we had this year. And that's really been reflective of the very strong pipeline of investments that we've built up, particularly in the area of the energy transition. I think one of the challenges there is that the timing of when these investments are going to be required to be made is quite uncertain. We would like it to be quicker, and I can talk more about that. But in the resource budget, that's been really challenging. It's been a 30% reduction over the last 2 years. We've managed to again navigate through that just by raising greater levels of income and through some in-year budget transfers that we've had from the Scottish Government to support things like international trade activity, for example. But I suppose the challenge is that we don't know what that settlement looks like next year. What I know is that in the resource budget that we're on the limit of our fixed costs. So we're actually, if we have a further reduction, even a slight reduction, we'll only just be able to cover our fixed costs and resource salaries, some of the diligence that we're required to perform in investments, that kind of thing. The financial transactions budget is very challenging. Again,
other members will ask about these areas. There'll be an opportunity to say a bit more, because sure. I'm about to hand over to Lorna Slater, who's going to pick up some of those. But before I move over to Lorna, do you have any comment on ScotWind and the decision around the revenues being moved to resource funding?
So I don't have a specific view on the sources of the income. Government will take those decisions, but I suppose it reflects the situation that we've been in, which is that we're having to use all the assets at our disposal to fund some of the nearer term opportunities.
The ScotWind money was meant to be for offshore and for renewables funding. It was raised in order to be invested into that sector. The proposal that's going to be spent to fund a short fall this year means that opportunity has been lost. Does that present any concerns to you or challenges for how we develop our renewables sector?
It's hard for me to comment on that because I don't know how that's going to play out into the resources that are going to be at our disposal. What I can tell you is that we've got an inward investment pipeline around the energy transition that is extremely strong. We have about 26,000 jobs in our inward investment pipeline at the moment. That's record levels. The timing of that is uncertain. So today, I don't have any demands on the capital budget that we can't resource, but that could change very significantly next year, depending on the pace at which some of these large inward investments come forward, because they do require large amounts of public sector funding. They're big projects, they involve thousands of jobs, but the timing is uncertain. So we have to be ready for that whenever it happens, and that I think is the challenge, rather than the quantum.
Okay. Right, I'll move over to Lorna Slater, followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. I've got three questions. The first one is for both organisations. Both of your business models, of course, depend very heavily, at the moment anyway, on government decisions year by year. And I know some every time I speak to an organisation, they're frustrated by not having foresight in terms of multi-year funding, not knowing what's coming. And so I'm interested in your comments on the sort of current system of how you are dependent on the capital budget that comes from the UK government, how that affects not knowing year to year what you're even going to have. And I'm interested from hearing from both of you, but particularly from SNP, from the investment bank, about how plans to make the bank stand alone commercially, as in not rolling any future profits back into the Scottish government budget, would help unlink that maybe. Obviously, Scottish Enterprise maybe doesn't have the same future options there.
Yes, so maybe I can come in on this one. So in terms of the certainty of funding, I think one of the things in terms of the challenges that the budget presents to us at the moment is we're income generative. And last year, for the first time, we generated income in excess of our operating costs. And I think the pressures around future year settlement at the point that we are in our evolution it poses a challenge, effectively. I think from an investment pipeline and a planning perspective, that certainty of what we have to invest from a financial transactions or a capital perspective would be helpful. As Al mentioned in his answer around the challenges, that pipeline that we have is full. So some sense of kind of multi-year settlement perhaps would allow us to better line up opportunities with the available funding. So I think that would be the primary area that more certainty would aid. I think in terms of that standalone basis. So we are moving out, as I say, in terms of resource budget, we're moving out of that being a resource consumer to hopefully, in the not too distant future, being an income generator from a net position. So, as to what happens with those with that excess, I guess we we would like to have line of sight and full ability to make decisions and reinvest that on behalf of the people of Scotland, and in time through our capital returns as well. We would also clearly like to see some element of recycling, you know, in terms of the returns that our portfolio would make. Oh, do you want to add anything?
I would just add, thank you, Michael, just add a couple of things. We are making multi-year investments. Very often you find you make a commitment and it will draw over 1, 2, 3 years. It generally doesn't draw there and then. There's often conditions to those drawings which are good risk management conditions to the drawings, rather than saying, here's a cheque for £10 million now, good luck. You know, we put gates and thresholds on those. So having that multi-year commitment is useful, but that's also useful, very importantly, for the Scotland, because many of those projects draw over multiple years as well. So I'd make that point for both topics we've discussed. We are now at the point, we expect to be at the point of our evolution in the next, well, we're certainly there at probably in the 25-26, of no longer requiring resource budget, because we're earning income over and above our resources. So we think hopefully that will take some pressure away from government on that point, going forward, to continue to support us on resource. On the capital side and the return of capital, I think there's a real opportunity here to actually take the proceeds that we are receiving back in the full due course of business and putting that to work again. And if you were to model that out going to, let's say, over the coming years, you could imagine getting to a position where the Scottish National Investment Bank would not require resource budget or capital budget at the point it gets to critical size to then operate and reinvest. And that's why reinvestment, or perpetual as we call it, is so important. And by doing that, you create a win-win, in my opinion. It's a win for the economy because you continue to create the economic benefit, the jobs, the growth, the carbon emissions, etc. And you decouple the bank from that funding challenge that I don't think will likely go away. I read the newspapers like everyone else, and I think we can be part of the solution to that while continuing to be providing the benefit if that perpetual recycling is allowed. So I would just give that strategic view. Thanks.
Morning. Yeah, the sight over future years budget is almost as important as the quantum of those budgets, and I think it's I'm sure it'll be the same for the bank as well, is that we are quite different from a lot of budgets across the Scottish Government in that we invest and we get a return rather than being a cost that delivers a resource. And that doesn't happen within the boundaries of a financial year. And the people that we invest alongside, because like the bank, we invest, everything we invest is alongside private sector partners. You can't stop and start that process depending on the budget that year. So when I talk about navigating, that's the navigating that we have to do, is try and keep the cadence of investments that we are sourcing and making happen aligned with an annual budget. It is something that we've highlighted to government. It's something that Douglas and colleagues spend a lot of time with our sponsor department and colleagues across Scottish Government Finance to understand the implications and how our model works, because it is quite different. But I'll bring Douglas in to comment further.
Yeah, I agree with Adrian. I mean, just having that certainty of the budget allows the planning. We're walking a fine line internally and with partners about the availability of the budget going forward, giving them the confidence that we will work alongside them. So that's kind of downside risk of doing it. We've navigated that very well internally. We're keeping the pressure on staff, as Adrian said, to develop project pipelines so that we've got good transformative projects. And that helps with the discussion of the government as well, because we demonstrate the kind of returns that we can make. Refer back here, for every £10 million of spend that Scottish Enterprise does, we deliver 725 jobs, we deliver about £250 million of cumulative GVA, and we deliver about £17 million of cumulative tax over a five-year period. So after about year four, that £10 million has been repaid and goes back into the Scottish Exchequer. So those are the kind of statistics that we're using in negotiation with the government and discussions with the government.
Thank you very much. I think that highlights clearly the frustration around how, even if we're not arguing about quantums, but how communication, especially between the two governments, about what might be coming in years down the line could be improved. Just picking up from my second question on what you were saying there, Douglas, around impact and evidencing that impact. So this is a question that I asked South of Scotland Enterprise and HIE when they were in last week. And that is about the difference. How do you measure the impact of your indirect support? So you obviously give out direct support, loans, grants, and so on, but it's indirect support. So I guess, how do you evidence the sort of teaching to fish versus the giving the fish? Because I got different answers from the two other enterprise agencies. South of Scotland Enterprise said they were in the process of delivering those metrics. HIE was less clear on how they showed what was the most effective intervention on the economy, because it's as great as it feels to sort of give out money, is that actually the most effective intervention on the economy, or are those other things just as or equally effective? Interested to hear your views.
I suppose I come back a bit on giving out money, because we invest alongside other private sector investments, and sometimes that investment is in the form of a grant, but you're getting a return for that, a very, very clear return. But to answer your question on advice, it's really hard to measure. I know the other enterprise agencies talked about the difficulty measure, because often that advice is to not do something, and you can't really measure the impact of not taking a particular course of action. What I do hear, though, from companies that we work with is just how critical that advice is. And I think also that is captured in our impacts and our evidence, because we don't just measure the impact of money that we co-invest. We measure the impact of the involvement that we've had in a project, which can be money or advice, normally a mix. But if I give you an example of Simon Howie, the Scottish butcher in Perthshire, I met him when he launched taking their electricity off grid. They generate power, they store power here. He said to me that actually our advice on that was more important than the financial commitment that we made to it. The impact of that is taking the entire production facility off grid, completely green powered, with battery storage as well. So I hear that very strongly from our customers, that our advice is absolutely critical. Measuring what you a course of action that's not taken is really hard, but we do capture the value of that in our outputs, because that reflects the scope of all of the support that we give, financial and non-financial.
Thank you. Sorry, very, very, very quick.
If it's very brief.
Super quick. So this one's just for the investment bank. I know you have, my understanding is that there's a limit of a minimum of £1 million that you could loan. And I just wonder what progress is there toward developing financial instruments that could be used to support smaller businesses and projects who don't need £1 million.
So we do believe that we have. So if I look at it, you know, in terms of what is the need of the ecosystem, what's the role that we play, we believe that on the equity investment side, which tends to be the smaller investments, there's a very clear need in the £2 to £10 million range, which is called the scale-up range within Scotland. And what tends to find is that, according to various studies that have been done on this part of the market, there is available finance for good businesses at that level, either from Scottish Enterprise or the Angels or other venture capitalists. But where there is a gap, a structural gap, and it's measured by a lot of commentators, is in that scale-up phase. So we think we can make more impact by focusing on that scale-up phase with, you know, the 1 million plus, and in fact we actually think probably moving towards the 2 million, but we set our limit at 1 million. What I would say is in the rural communities we will consider going below that because some of the projects are a little bit smaller. On the infrastructure side, I think that's where you tend to do your bigger investments, your 20 to 50 million pound investments, and that's slightly different, and that's providing a de-risking function to allow other investors to come alongside. And that's more of a development bank function in that regard.
Thank you.
I'll bring in Brian Whittle, who will be followed by Gordon MacDonald. Can I just ask, Neb, at the start of the meeting you talked, I think it was 650 million of the 2 billion capitalisation. The capitalisation 2 billion was announced in 2020. Are you still confident that will be the investment that will be delivered? And given our financial situation, but are you confident the 2 billion will be delivered over the timescale?
Well, we certainly believe that the commitment was made and the commitment will be delivered. Mm-hmm. That's our working assumption. And in fact, in that regard, we have in our business plan, we've smooth-lined the balance over the balance of the year. So I think it works out 230 million per annum in our business plan going forward. Okay. So, but yes, that's an assumption that that commitment will be delivered.
Okay, thank you. Brian Whittle to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you. Good morning, panel. Can I just sort of tie off some of the questioning that my colleague Lorna Slater was saying? Mr. Robertson, you talked about this sort of financial planning in the sort of one-year, you know, planning that we have at the moment. The Scottish Government sort of medium-term financial strategy is assuming, you know, no financial transactions beyond 24-25, but of course, you know, some of the funding in financial transactions generally extend beyond a year. So how does that uncertainty, how is that impacting, you know, sort of investment decisions going forward?
Yeah, I mean, I think as Al talked about as well, there is a mismatch between the annual settlements that we would receive and the drawdown profiles of the commitments they were making to businesses. So we have to effectively ensure that we can fund the future commitments effectively of the bank beyond any one financial year end. So the additional FTs or capital budget that then flows in is really assessed on the basis of what we have in our pipeline looking forward after those commitments have been accounted for, if you like. So it does make it challenging to match up that pipeline and what we're going to commit to the settlement effectively.
I don't know if there's anybody else wants to comment before I move on in that.
Adrian. Yeah, the financial transactions budget is absolutely critical for us. We were really concerned going into this financial year that we wouldn't be able to meet our usual cadence of early stage investments and the impact that would have on the pipeline that then finds its way to the bank and to other scale-up investors. We were able to keep the income that we generate from past investments through financial transactions this year, which has allowed us to keep that function going. We've also topped it up from our regular capital budget with about £10 million. Even with that, we're not able to meet the same level of early stage investments that we've been able to meet in the past. So that is a concern for us and an uncertainty for next year. What we're trying to do is we're trying to bring more international capital into the early stage investment market, either to scale up the activity there or to compensate for any lack of funding that may exist from us, but it's a really big issue. Our investment function is absolutely critical for us. That's why we transferred that £10 million from capital into our investment budget this year, because it's co-investment, and if we don't keep that pipeline going, that has a very immediate impact on the economy.
Okay, thank you. Can I indicate, Mr. Denholm, around the where you see the SNB sitting between that 2 and £10 million, that sort of scale? And that, you know, Scottish Enterprise perhaps set the stage before that. So I really want to talk about how the, because it's becoming a more cluttered market. I know GB Energy now have entered into the market as well, apparently. How that the agencies managed to collaborate together, and sort of, is there a demarcation between agencies, and how do we make the money that's available, especially public money, most effective? I'll come to you, Mr. Denholm.
Me first, okay, thank you. So the good news, I think, from you, I would hope from your perspective, is that the various agencies do collaborate and work together in a congenial and supportive way, but within our own boundaries and our own remits. And so Scottish Enterprise, I clearly understand and work with Adrian, and we have meetings with the senior management, for example, on a periodic basis. The investment teams are also very aware of each other. They can pick up the phone to each other and they know each other. And sometimes we'll be referring things that are too small for us to SE, and SE will sometimes be referring things to us. So that day-to-day works well. With other agencies in the ecosystem, and we've now got an MOU, Memorandum of Understanding, with UKIB. We also see that as a collaborative way of working. Their minimum ticket size is actually quite conveniently about our maximum, so they also refer to us. But what we there is an overlap. But, you know, I mentioned Ardersier. We both put in £50 million into Ardersier, but it was, in that example, I think it's fair to say, we picked up the phone to them. and told them about the idea, then they came along. And we've got another one or two deals that we haven't yet announced where we are working with them. So again, it's collaborative. Again, they've got their mandate, we've got our mandate. GB Energy, I think, is also, I look at it as more capital coming in to support the economy, which is a good thing. So I see that as a take. The key thing is that we work collaboratively, and we're already working with and reaching out to GB Energy leaders and Scottish Government leaders, and I know that UK Government and Scottish Government are talking about this as well. So I think if we can all work collaboratively to work out how to make the most of this, then I think that would be a beneficial thing from my benefit of the economic situation in Scotland's perspective.
I think we have developed a really strong partnership with the bank and other investors in the private sector and the public sector. We invest earlier. We invest about an average 6 years earlier than the bank, if we look at the average of the companies that we've supported. But of the published deals that the bank has done, we have been involved in over half of those at the earlier stages. And I think we've managed that interface really well. So there are companies where we've actually, they've been just at the kind of point of that demarcation where we've both invested at that stage. And then there will be a natural kind of handoff to the bank after that. And I say that sharing not just of deal flow, but of market conditions. And critically as well, I think the partnership has grown much stronger in inward investments and how we support inward investments. That package of support, which involves some grant funding, some funding for large infrastructure as well, I see that playing through very strongly now. I think we've made that work actually very well. There's a demarcation. What's more important, as I said, is the teamwork and the spirit of collaboration. I think that exists.
A slight follow-on from that then, if there's that sort of, good to hear, obviously, collaboration between, you know, different funding agencies or different business agencies. And if there's a co-investment, sort of partnership co-investment, how do you measure the success, both together and separately?
So, there wouldn't be that many instances where we would... So there are some interface where we've had a historic investment and the bank has come in. There wouldn't be that many of them. The success would be actually getting the deal done because it wouldn't have happened otherwise. And sometimes actually being able to make the company go further, faster as a result of that joint investment. But the return would be how we monitor all of our investment returns, which is the amount of private sector leverage that's been leveraged in. And for us, that's about 1 to 3. But also really just how it allows that company to not have to focus so much on where it's raising the next piece of funding from, but to get that certainty over scale-up funding that allows the management to focus on the products and the markets and to go faster. That's quite hard to measure, but again, that feedback will tend to come from the company and the success that the company has. But all too often, we've seen companies in the past who've been focused on fundraising to the detriment of actually focusing on their customers and their markets.
Mr. Daniel,
I'd
obviously
like to just build upon what Adrian has just said. One of the things that I think is very important to consider is that whenever we're looking at an investment, no matter where it's been sourced from, we will always look at that as a standalone investment. We're operationally independent. It's a very important premise for us, and we will look at good investments. Now, what we have found so far in our investment portfolio, we've had 12 investments in our equity portfolio that have had Scottish Equitable in the stack, but there's other ones as well that are not. So we're not just a funnel, if you like, pass through and pass the baton. We have to look at it as a standalone investment, and there have been opportunities where we said, actually, that's not for us. So we do look at it as a standalone. I think it's very important if I look at the ecosystem and how companies develop, and Adrian picked upon this, how a company develops in its early years is very important. The skills training it gets, the support it gets, you know, how to structure itself, how to tell its story, make sure it's got a good board, etc., is really important. There's a large number of great ideas that never make it to commercial success. And I think it's very important the role that we play. And we play that role in the scale-up phase. And I think it's fair to say Adrian and High and Sosie play the role in the earlier stage. But I don't want to give the impression that it's an automatic pass the baton, because we still will look at it as a commercial investment with an impact lens in the context of our own budget and what our other priorities might be.
and we'll continue to support the company through our international trade, through our business growth support as well. So there's the investment handoff, but our involvement with the company supporting it to develop remains.
Can I just finish for a really quick...
If it's brief, then I'm going to bring Gordon
just to Mr. Glyth, I just want you just to clarify something. You still invest under EIS, and is there still no capital gains after 3 years? Is that still the investment that's available at the moment?
So we don't invest under EIS, but some of our partners do. Uh-huh. Yeah. So that would be it doesn't impact on us, but it impacts on our co-investors.
And it's no capital gains after 3 years. Is that the way that works?
I believe so. I could check that out for you. But
okay, that's fine. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, panel. And before I ask my questions, I just want to thank Scottish National Investment Bank for the investment in the Lost Shore, Scotland's only surf resort, which will open in my constituency in a few weeks' time, hopefully. Not that I'll be on the water. Absolutely. I wanted to ask about the financial transaction funding that's been cut. Scottish Government's overall financial transaction fund has been cut by 62% compared to 22-23, or around £350 million. And we know the Scottish Government has virtually no borrowing powers. So it's in a bit of a straitjacket. And we've seen financial transaction funding being cut year on year to the low level it currently is. If that continues to be cut, what impact will that have on your organisations?
Well, I mean, if it continues to be cut, it'll obviously have a negative impact on our ability to deliver on our mission. So it's very important, I would say, and we would say, and I'm sure speaking on behalf of everyone in this panel, that we are creating a good economic and social benefit from that money. At the end of the day, I think it's up to others to decide how to deploy the budgets, but we think we're making a very strong case for it being deployed in our direction because of the benefits that we can bring.
So, yes, sorry.
So I was just going to add to that as well, that point around the income generation as well and our ability to invest in projects that will make a return to cover our operating costs. That is a consequential of almost a compounding effect of lower budgets year on year. Yeah. And at the stage that we're at in our evolution, you know, that sustained financial self-sustainability is in a kind of critical point.
Yeah, absolutely.
And if I could add one last point that goes back to Ms. Slater's point, the ability to recycle and become perpetual will help remove some of that challenge over time, but it won't remove it today, it will remove it in a few years' time. We believe we're about to start getting some returns. We can forecast that, and getting those returns coming back in would be beneficial and add to the economic impact that we can make. So it's a critical question, and I think it's a well-asked question.
So multi-year, you've spoke a lot about a lot of these projects are multi-year. So if you are to honour the commitments to these companies that you've given for their investment profile, what impact does that have on new projects, and what impact does that have on the leverage that you've got to get private capital to invest in a project?
That's a great question as well. So coming into this year, we were budgeting, I'll give you an example to bring that to life. So coming into this year, we were, I think, budgeting, it was £250 million in our management accounts and our planning, our business planning process, and we ended up with £173. Now, what that means in practice is that, to your question, you've got some existing plans and commitments. We effectively had £80 million less to spend on new things or new investments, effectively. The gap, it means it's... We do less and we have to be more selective. And we made that point in our annual report. We've had to change some of our criteria, tightening up a wee bit, which means we've had to decline a number of things that in prior years we might have looked at. So that's a key element of the impact it would have, and the planning of that impact as well.
Chair Price.
Thanks. Well, I suppose the impact depends on what governments choose to do about it. If the Scottish Government replaced that with additional capital funding, then we can reinvest that and we can get a return from that further down the line. I hope the UK Government will continue financial transactions. There I can't emphasise what important source of funding they are for us. Just on the radio this morning, a company called My Algae, they're through to the final of the Earthship Prize. Brilliant young company. We've supported them all the way from their inception 2016. I'm sure they've got a very bright future. I guess the bit in that story that wasn't told this morning was that through our ownership, the people of Scotland own a significant stake in that company, and I've got a stake in its success as well. But also further down the line, when we get an exit from that company, we can reinvest that in the economy. So last year, just over £30 million of investment income from our previous investments. That's in quite a deflated exit market over the last couple of years as well. So 2 years ago, that was over £100 million income we made. £560 million income over the last 5 years we've made. So that reduces our dependency on government funding. But we've also put it to government as well that we would like to be able to retain more of that income and reinvest more of that income. Some of that goes back centrally. But I think that affects our behaviour in terms of how we behave towards investments and how commercial that we are towards those investments. So there are some... the ability to do that, but also the ability to carry some funding over from year to year would really help with that predictability and that smoothing. I don't know if you want to add anything to that, Douglas, but we've made quite a strong case to allow us to do that and to behave probably more like the bank commercially from the point of view of investments.
Yeah, the market's really focused on follow-on investment. So one of the consequences, and I'm sure it'll be the same for the bank, not being able to follow on dilutes effectively the returns effectively you get downstream. So over the sort of 21 years we've been running investment, we've secured 2.5 billion of leveraged private sector investment alongside it. We've realised £500 million from that portfolio already, and it's worth £478 million at the moment. But the potential is, if we can't follow on the investment, and we've stressed this to the Scottish Government, the impact that has, not just on the early stage investment market, but also on our ability to recycle and generate income, which will actually support economic development in Scotland.
Sorry, I was going to ask a question, then I'll come back to you, if you don't mind. Adrian, you mentioned that it changes your attitude towards investment, etc. I mean, what is the change in your appetite to risk, and if your budget is continued to be cut because of financial transactions, what impact will that have on losses? That, you know, any investment is from time to time there will be the occasional loss. So how, you know, does that affect your attitude to risk? And do you then have to reassess a lot of these potential investments because you know that your budget's being cut?
Yeah, that's a great question. Whether it would affect our attitude to risk, I think it would, the same as we've done across the piece with all of our grant funding, it would take us to the much higher impact and we'd have to draw the line higher. Now that would probably take you to a higher level of risk as well, because you know you're in a risk return scenario there, so we probably take more risk. Interestingly, when losses are written off, it's not the financial transactions budget that comes from. That comes from our resource budget, and is quite unpredictable as well. And sometimes actually those write-offs are from investments that we've made even 15 years ago. So it's extremely hard to predict. But I think that would take us to a place probably of looking for more risk and more return at the same time. But I think just to stress, you know, this is a model that's 21 years old now, this early stage co-investment fund. It's very mature. It's leveraged in, as Douglas said, over £2 billion of other income. But we're heavily reliant on it now as a source of income. So if you cut off the pipeline, that will play out further down the line. So it's really, really important. And as I say, we'll take any steps, whether that's through our own means or through raising that funding from international private markets to keep that going. It's really important to us.
So similar question to yourself, Al, but mentioning that what you said earlier about your investment income exceeded operational expenses by about, what, £3 million roughly. But you did have a big loss from Circularity Scotland. We know the reasons for that. I mean, how would you be able to cope with that in future, and also losses like that in future? And also, has your risk appetite changed in any way?
So two elements to that, and Michael, please come in and add to this. As I mentioned earlier, we're a young bank and we're still maturing, so those early losses will have more consequential impact on our P&L in the early years than they might have in future years. So that's point one. But as you model out, you know, assuming the target rate of return, which we've now published, and assume a recurring or reinvestment rate, we think we'd be able to absorb those from the income statement going forward if we do good underwriting and we make good investment decisions. Obviously, as you said, every investment has a risk side to it, otherwise it wouldn't be called investment. And you wouldn't get a return on it if it was risk-free. So that would be something that we think we can smooth out and absorb in future, but it's more consequential in the early days. But as you move out into years 6, 7, 8, 9, then it's absorbable. And the same goes to the recyclability. You then, you know, so that absorbable means it doesn't place a pressure on the Exchequer for more resource budget, because just now in the early years that falls back onto the Exchequer in the way we've been set up. In the future, also the same works for the capital. If that can get recycled and build up over time, it reduces the pressure. So there is a point in time, you know, because we're investing commercially, getting a commercial return, and because hopefully we are doing solid quality underwriting, we will get a positive, we can get to a position that we will be what I would call off the books, both from a capital and an income perspective. But that's not here yet, but that's out there, and it's not that far away. If we can keep this going, so if we can keep getting the FT, the 250, 200 a year, whatever the number is, that allows us to build that critical mass. And it's like a flywheel that just keeps going at that point, becomes a national wealth fund for Scotland that will create benefits both financially and societally. You also asked me about the third party, and I think it's a good point to come in on that one as well, because I didn't answer it the first time. We, as I mentioned earlier, we've crowded in about a 2-to-1 ratio so far, 650 plus 1.4. If that was put at risk, you put at risk the crowding in element. The other element I think is important to note is because we're now getting to the stage that we're being noticed by other asset owners, you know, I mean some of the larger asset owners, so we've been crowding in some of the smaller asset owners, but we're now getting noticed by some of the household name asset owners as the kind of people that we might partner with. And we've got no announcements that we want to make. It's just at this point, but we are getting to the point that we think we can be a solution to what they would like to do in Scotland as well. Because I don't want to give names, but a number of asset owners say it's difficult to invest in Scotland, but they see the benefit of us working with them to help them do that. And that's why our FCA authorization is very, very important. And if that opportunity was to disappear, that might, you know, that would also have a negative impact on the opportunity we could create for Scotland. So that's very important. And we're just at that point that we're getting those very positive vibes from those big asset owners to invest money in Scotland.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Sorry, Bob Doris, do you wish a supplementary on these points?
Please.
I will let you in before Kevin Stewart.
I'll seek to be brief. It was specifically, I think, Gordon McDonald's line of questioning to Al Denham about how the removal of financial transactions revenues, capital revenues, may have changed the investment decisions made by the Scottish National Investment Bank. And you mentioned, Mr. Denham, we talked about target rate of return and reinvestment rate, but a thread through the whole thing was trying to support Scotland's moving to net zero by 2045. Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering if the investment decisions being made will lead the investment bank to sometimes making decisions which will prioritise investment return and sustainability rather than maximising the pursuit of net zero by 2045. We've all got a horse in this race, but I'm on the net zero committee in the Scottish Parliament. We're looking at 5-year carbon budgets. We're looking about the next plan in relation to all of this. So, and we know we need to leverage in major private investment, more so than public investment, to get to net zero. So our investment decisions been changed and altered that might compromise that private investment because of the removal of the UK financial transactions revenues?
So I would say clearly the magnitude of the financial transactions will have a compromising effect on the ability to deliver that. So that, that and I think I've answered on that topic. But what I'd like to stress is that whenever we make an investment decision, we look at it through both lenses, both impact and commercial return, and they're both equally important to us. And we will not do an investment that doesn't have the impact benefit, and we won't do an investment that doesn't have a commercial return. But it has to be both. And what we've noticed, specifically to net zero, we've been up and running for 3.5 years, and we've now had something like 1,200 inquiries come into the bank. Of those, in terms of pounds and pence, and also numbers, about half of them have been net zero focused specifically. So we see lots of demand for our capital, and I don't know if you've had the opportunity, but in our annual report and also our impact report, we've publicly stated that we will seek to invest roughly 50% of that 2 billion capital on net zero, roughly 25% on place, and roughly 25% on innovation.
Can I just check, Mr. Denham, that what I'm trying to establish is whether that will shift because of the need to get to sustainability in a quicker timescale because of the loss of revenues elsewhere, or will the pattern remain the same?
The investment pattern and the investment process will remain the same. It's the amount of money that we're doing it with that will differ. And hopefully I'm not missing your point, but that's how I view it. You know, we are committed to net zero, we're committed to place, we're committed to innovation with the money that we're given. And impact and commercial are the two lenses that we look at, and that won't change.
Can I just check, is it exactly the same for Scottish Enterprise?
It's exactly the same in terms of impact and the prioritisation that we give. And I think, you know, investment markets are sophisticated, it's demanded. It's a requirement, it's not an option that we have. But I would say, you know, given the pressure on financial transactions this year, there was a specific net zero early stage technology fund that we wanted to take forward that we weren't able to take forward within the current. We've had to put it on hold in the current
environment. Which is concerning, and I won't go back in after this community. I just, from the line of Ms McDonald's question, I thought maybe, obviously, you have to look at investment through the lens of the greatest impact, including net zero ambitions, but also greatest return to allow both Scottish Enterprise and SNB to get sustainability as quickly as possible. That hasn't compromised net zero investment in any way, has it?
I can't think of any examples where it's compromised net zero investment other than opportunities that we can't pursue at the moment. So we saw a gap in the market for early stage investment in net zero, and lots of investors who are specifically in that market and a focused fund, but we can't take that forward at the moment. So that's not to say we will never take it forward, but we can't take it forward at the moment. So the implication would be that's slowing things down.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Kevin Stewart, followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. My questions are for Scottish Enterprise in the main. And Mr Gillespie, you already mentioned the three missions that exist in your new strategy. What I'm interested in terms of the impacts that you have talked about in terms of budget, particularly in terms of that cuts to financial transactions, what will you not be doing in the future that you would want to do because of that hit, particularly from FTs? Have you looked at the economic impact of all of this? And can I also ask, in terms of the strategy, sometimes there are critical voices in my constituency and beyond that your concentration is far too much on inward investment rather than growing our own. What would you say to those critics?
Okay. I've just referenced a fund that we're not taking forward at the moment, given the pressure on financial transactions. I talked last time about some of the savings that we've made in office premises to make up for the lack of funding that we have in resource funding, for example. It can be a bit more difficult to talk about what we've stopped doing because we've not taken away lines of business, we've not stopped taking away trade support, we've not taken away support that we give around innovation. But what we have done is we've raised the bar in terms of what we expect to see come out the other side for projects that we'll support, and this focus on transformational projects within each of those missions. So transformational being, it has to make a fundamental difference to the company's future. It can't just be about supporting a bit of incremental growth. Now, the support we've delivered in the past around growth delivered a good economic return. So it's not to say that, you know, we shouldn't have been doing that. It did deliver a good return. We just can't afford to do it anymore, and we've had to raise the bar around what we expect to see. And some of those figures I gave you up front about the job numbers would actually start to bear out that that strategy is working. But what the impact of what we're not doing is a very hard thing to establish. But at £25 GVA for every £1 invested, you could see that you could actually take that back quite significantly in terms of its return and still be delivering a very, very good return.
Okay, critics?
Critics. So we have a very strong track record in inward investment that we're very pleased with. It delivers an awful lot of economic return. It delivers great jobs. It delivers brilliant outputs in terms of exports, R&D. And it gets a lot of profile because they're quite lumpy investments. But our evidence in terms of the number of companies that we support and where our support ends up doesn't bear out that we, and certainly the number of people that we've got employed delivering inward investment versus delivering trade support for companies from Scotland or innovation support is in the minority of our people. So I do think there's a bit of a misconception here that's reflected just by the amount of media attention that these large inward investments bring.
Maybe you have to deal with those media commentary, but also I think you need to do more in actually letting folk know what you're up to. You said that you wouldn't really be investing in incremental growth so much in the future, but what if that growth includes innovation? How are you going to invest in innovation and companies that already exist here in Scotland? And beyond the company aspect in itself, there's been a lot of talk this morning about cooperation. What is your cooperation with the research sector in our universities so that the knowledge that innovation that we're coming up with here actually leads to manufacturing and jobs here?
Sure. Okay. And just on the first point, doing more, I would love to get more coverage in the media over some of the great work that's done in early stage investment and innovation. It's really hard. We try really hard. What's more successful is through our social media channels. Please do connect to me on LinkedIn. We do an awful lot of direct communication about what we're doing with companies on LinkedIn. Innovation is really important to us, and innovation tends to underpin some of that transformational growth opportunities that we see. You'll see that one of our missions is about scaling up innovation. So we have a brilliant track record in innovation in Scotland. We have some really innovative life sciences companies, space companies, you know, the list goes on, quantum technologies. But getting that to levels of scale where they significantly impact the economy is the challenge that we've set ourselves. That's difficult, both at a company level and at a sector level. But this is the kind of thing that I think a National Economic Development Agency should be doing. So from that point of view, innovation actually underpins not just our scaling mission, but the other missions that we've set ourselves as well. So it's critically important. And our partnerships with universities are fundamentally a part of that. So if you look at some of the investments we've made, the National Manufacturing Institute for Scotland, the Medicines Manufacturing Innovation Centre, which has just leveraged in £25 million of funding, the BioQuarter in Edinburgh, the Life Sciences Innovation Hub, we've just co-invested with the University of Dundee. These are really critical investments. Our role there is helping the university to really scale up their innovation potential and make sure that their brilliant research transfers into the economy at scale.
The strategy itself is a long-term strategy. And, you know, all of this is about delivery. How are you monitoring whether that strategy, the missions that you have set yourself, are actually delivering for companies and for the people of Scotland?
So we, in a couple of ways, first of all, are our headline measures. So our headline measures around jobs created, around capital investment leveraged, around levels of innovation, they come from the companies that we're working with. That's where they are sourced from. So that's delivered through our missions. But we also, in terms of the longer term targets that we've set for emissions, these 675 scale-ups, for example, the 40,000 jobs in the energy transition, we monitor that on an annual basis. We're 6 months into delivering that emissions focus now, so at the end of each year we will publish our progress around how we've delivered on each of the missions within the framework of our overall headline measures, which we report to you each year.
You will publish a report on how you think you've done. How do you gather up from folks out there how they think you've done?
So we do that in the main through some of the focus groups that we have with customers. I do it personally just through visiting as many companies as I can during the year. Our people do that. I note the comments you made about some of the critics. In terms of our key partners, both in the private sector and the public sector, I've had great encouragement and support about the direction that we're taking. I think it's right for a National Economic Development Agency to be focused on the prize of the renewables transition, on the prize of taking our brilliant innovation and making sure that's felt at scale throughout the economy, because that pushes up wages, it pushes up prosperity. And thirdly, productivity does the same thing. We should be investing more in the future of our economy, and we should be doing that at scale. And the result of that, productivity means better jobs. So I've had a great level of support. I'm in this role, there are always going to be some people who are unhappy, and the more that you do raise the bar, then I suppose you're leaving yourself open to that. But that's the situation that we're in. I would stress, though, that the strategy does seem to be playing out. We did start the energy successfully. The energy transition mission we launched earlier, just given the pressing nature of it. Our inward investment pipeline in terms of new inward investors, now over half of that is in the energy transition area. We're seeing a huge increase in exports from the work that we're doing in energy transition. We've resourced that much better. So around 23% increase in our exports in energy transition. So the early signs, I think, are very positive. We will monitor that very closely. But so far, I'm pleased with what I'm seeing.
In answers to colleagues, you have highlighted the impact of the 62% cut to financial transactions budget. Obviously, we have a budget coming up on the 30th of October. What would the impact be in terms of being able to deliver your strategy if the Treasury does not reinstate those financial transactions monies that were available before to the Scottish Government and to yourself?
So again, that would depend on what the Scottish Government chose to do about that, I suppose, in that situation, the extent to which we would repurpose capital that's in very, very, very short supply. So I would imagine that would be a very difficult situation. And I would imagine the outcome would be that we wouldn't get the levels of financial transaction type funding that we've had in the past, and that would have a significant impact on what we're able to do in the early stage investment market.
So it would be fair to say if financial transactions budgets don't change, don't increase again, if capital investment from the Treasury doesn't increase, that makes all of your jobs much more difficult, and it would be much more difficult to sustainably grow the Scottish economy?
Yes, that would be, it would be more challenging, there's no doubt about that. We take some of the responsibility for fixing that situation on ourselves in terms of other sources of private sector income. And for example, we work with other partners like Innovate UK, who we deliver a joint service with in Scotland, and they fund 16 of our people, for example. So we are taking steps, but it does make it much, much harder, and it's a critical part of what we do.
And it would be much more difficult to lever in private investment if we don't have that kickstart money from the UK.
So it's that 1-3 leverage that we get. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank
you, Convener. Focus. Colin Smith, followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Apologies for not being there, but I didn't want to spread this cold to everyone this morning. So I hope you can hear me okay. Mr Gillespie, you commented earlier that the 30% cut in Scottish Enterprise Resource Budget by the Scottish Government over the past 2 years means you're now in danger of not being able to cover your fixed costs. Can you elaborate on what this would mean if you saw a further funding reduction in the forthcoming budget. I mean, does that mean redundancies, recurring commitments not being delivered? What's the implication of any more cuts in your budget?
Sure. Okay, I should stress that's a real terms cut rather than a quantum cut. So that's with inflation taken into account, that reduction. But it does show that we've had very significant challenges in that area. I mentioned that we've taken steps around office closures, around efficiencies where we can, digital delivery. We do feel we've kind of reached the stage of exhausting some of those efficiencies, and that any further efficiencies would be really, really tough. So we're on the margins of having to make some even more difficult decisions should the resource funding be shrunk further. I don't envisage redundancies. Part of the savings that we're making is that we're reducing over time the level of staff resource. So that's reduced over the past year by 20. We do that through retirements and the natural turnover of people. So I don't envisage us making redundancies. So we're watching that outcome really closely, but I'll maybe let Douglas elaborate more on some of the implications. But we would have to consider stopping doing some things which we're legally obliged to do. So we obviously don't want to be in that situation.
Yeah, thanks, Adrian. The Ardell budget covers, as Adrian said, we've got our kind of fixed costs, which are fixed in the short to medium term. So that's the kind of outlook we're looking at. We'd probably need to look further at rationalisation of offices, for example. We've successfully secured a lot of savings from rationalising our overseas footprint, as well as and co-locating with the Foreign Commonwealth Office, as well as closing a couple of offices or a few offices in Scotland. The implication is, against a fixed cost and a declining budget, it's the kind of operational economic development activities that potentially suffer as a consequence of that, because those are the things that you can do in the short term, which is obviously not a great position to be in for us. And specifically, that would be trade and inward investment type activities, innovation support, skills support that we provided to companies through our Training Plus programme. So those are the kind of things we're looking at. As Adrian said, we're looking through our financial strategy to see whether we can leverage in additional income, whether we can generate more income there. And Adrian alluded to it, there's an asymmetrical treatment in terms of our investment income, where upside gains are limited to 5%, whereas if we suffer a loss, a full 100% goes against the Ardell budget. So there are things that we're raising with the Scottish Government, who in turn are raising that with the UK Government in terms of how we can maybe address some of those things.
Just following that up, the point was made that you wouldn't be able to meet your legal obligations with any more cuts. What are those legal obligations you're referring to?
Well, we're at the cusp of roughly about £120 million worth of fixed costs in that short to medium term. So we would have office accommodation, leases, etc. So if we suffer a cut that takes us down below where a level where we couldn't sustain it through income, then obviously we'd be potentially in danger of breaching some of those obligations. So it's things like that. We obviously take tax advice, etc. We just and legal advice on things. So we just need to make sure that we remain, you know, regular and above board, if you like.
And the diligence as well. Sorry, the diligence that we undertake on investments, that kind of thing, that's funded from the same budget. Sorry.
Okay. And the committee is obviously looking towards the future budget and being optimistic. Should there be even a part reversal of the cuts you face from the Scottish Government, what would the priority be for any additional resources? What would the impact be of that additionality on delivering that crucial economic growth that we want to see?
Depends which budget we're talking about. So if it's the resource budget, it'd probably be increased trade activity. We had a very, very successful second highest year in terms of our export support. It has been on an upward trajectory over the last 5 years. That would be something, obviously, we'd want to do more on. There would be, if it was the FT's budget, we've talked about that at some length. If it was capital budget, as Adrian said, we've got a large inward investment pipeline, a pipeline that will address some of the challenges in net zero. We're also working with the Scottish Government because they've got the offshore wind fund as well. So we're looking to access that. So it would be looking at those things and scaling up. So it's, as Adrian said, a lot of the activity that we're doing at the moment, or a lot of the consequence of cuts, has been that things have slowed down, so it would be accelerating those things, and particularly in the opportunity in offshore wind. That's where we see the greatest benefit for Scotland in terms of economic development outcomes.
Okay, thanks for that. Can I turn to the Scottish National Investment Bank and the announcement in June of the target rate of return of 3-4% for the bank up to and including 25-26. Can I ask, how does that target rate of return compare with similar institutions such as other development banks?
Yeah, thanks for the question. So in terms of other development banks, when we were setting that initial target rate of return at 3-4%, we looked across the UK, Europe and further afield as well. So I think in terms of comparison with UK development banks, I think UKIB is 2.5-3.5%. Return on equity, so we're slightly above that measure, and the British Business Bank I think was 1.5-2.5%, and there are obviously there are slight nuances within portfolio makeup and target markets etc. But we think it compares, it's a comparable measure to those other organisations.
And how do you anticipate that target evolving post 25-26?
So the reason that we have kind of set that 31st of March 26 as the measurement date is really to allow our portfolio to have matured and our equity investments to have, or our initial equity investments to have been embedded for a reasonable period of time. So we will use that point of measurement at 26 with a view to informing us as to a longer term measure.
And do you have a view on whether that target's likely to, is it something that's going to reduce, or are you looking to scale that up further beyond that 3-4% target beyond 25-26? No, I'll ask you to have a crystal ball, but you know, what is your longer term strategy, I suppose, for that target rate?
Yeah, so we value our portfolio regularly, and obviously that seeks to inform where we think we will land. We're still fairly early, I guess, in our evolution at 3.5 years. By the time we get to March 26, there'll be another 18 months added to that. So that maturity of the portfolio is heading in the right direction, but there's obviously another 18 months to go. I wouldn't like to. As you say, the crystal ball is not so strong today, so I wouldn't like to hazard, I guess, what the longer-term picture might be, but I think we'll be in a better place then to inform us of what that performance is to that date and what it might do to a longer-term target.
Yeah. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Murdo Fraser to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. I'd like to ask a bit about financial performance, and maybe first of all to SNB, following on from the questions earlier from Lorna Slater. SNB was established to be a perpetual institution with profits being reinvested. When we had your chair, Willie Watt, in front of the committee last year, our colleague Michelle Thompson asked Mr. Watt about this question, and he said at that point, "Government accounting rules are not helpful in that regard, but we are talking to the Scottish Government about those issues." So I wonder if you can give us any update on that challenge and whether it's been proving to be easier to reinvest profits, or is there still a barrier to that happening?
Wayne, Michael, you come in, protocol more tactically if you can. So we are talking to Scottish Government about this, and I think Adrian made the point, we're an investment department and therefore our body, and therefore we're different and unusual from many other cost centres or spending centres. And I think getting that message over is something that we've been working on to land that very important message. I think where we have had some challenges has been some, I'll be honest, has been some of the turnover in some of the key stakeholders, and also with the UK general election has also created some barriers in terms of the ability to engage. I think where we're now at is we're now at the point that our message is being heard, and I think that's important, and I think we're now trying to work through the mechanics of how to solve it with good intent to seek to solve it from the people that we're talking to. But we're still on a journey and we've still got a long way to go. And the reason, the principal reason, I think, if I'm looking at, Michael's in the detail on this one, but I'm looking to read it, a large part of it is because we're different and the system doesn't quite know how to deal with something that's different in this regard. We're an investment institution that's seeking to reinvest, perpetual, etc., looking for multi-year, looking for flex over year-end. I mean, one of the challenges we face, if you know, that happened last year, we got to the 31st of March and we didn't know if we were actually going to be able to do a £50 million deal according to the rules. But we got it done and we didn't compromise our underwriting in doing it. But that's the kind of real-life challenge we've got. And what you don't want to have is a situation where the people you're negotiating with know that that's a real-life challenge that you have and try to play that against us, because that's actually not in the Scottish taxpayers' benefit that we would be doing something that wouldn't be beneficial. So there's lots of reasons why this would be beneficial. Flex, as Adrian mentioned, would be the first part, then reinvesting, then so on. But it's large part is because we're different. And,
okay. Mr. Robertson, come in, but just so I'm clear, are these Treasury accounting rules, or are they Scottish Government rules, or where is the blockage?
So, in terms of the perpetual status, it's UK budgeting manual effectively, and the pots and the permissions, and I think Douglas referred to earlier on as well around, you know, it's hugely complicated around even the gains that are received on particular assets and where those flows are directed to. We talked about there about, you know, early stage losses would go against the resource budget, for example, but it doesn't consequentially follow that gains will also go against the resource budget. So there are some inconsistencies, if you like, with treatment of both of losses and gains. It's effectively UK budgeting rules, and it affects not just us, it affects some of our counterparties within the rest of the UK as well. So other organisations are also dealing with the same challenges in that space. Okay. I think where we do see the potential for advancement within, you know, within the Scottish rules is just around flexibility and potentially multi-year as well.
All right, thank you. Can I ask a couple of other questions around financial performance for SNB? First of all, you'll be aware that the issue of bankers' bonuses is very politically contentious. I'm aware that SNB pay bonuses, there is a long-term incentive plan that sets out performance conditions which relate to bonuses. What are those performance measures that determine whether bonuses are paid?
So the first thing that I would say, set a bit of context in answering your question, is when we were set up, the Scottish Government looked across the ecosystem to work out what should the right pay and reward package be for staff in the sector that we operate in. And in doing that, they looked at the public sector, they looked at the financial and they looked at the private sector, and they looked at other development banks. And they came up with something that I think is a bit of all of those elements in what our package is. So our package is not a pure private sector package, it's not a pure public sector package, it's something that's a bit in between. And I think it seeks to meet a compromise that would work. One of the biggest elements of what we're trying to do is we're competing with ultimately the private sector for our talent, because there's very few people in the public sector that have the skill set to do the kind of investing that we're doing, the structuring and so on. And so we've got to really try to attract that talent. And that private sector does tend to pay a base salary plus a performance-related bonus. Now, In terms of the magnitude, as I said, we're not there, and we're not there. We're somewhere in between. So I wanted to make that point. But the very fact that we have a strong mission impact statement helps us bridge part of that gap with some of the people that we're hiring and our staff retention and engagement comes from that as much as from their from any other factor. When it comes to the actual long-term incentive program performance conditions, those are set on an annual basis as a forward-looking basis. And the reality is that I think it's noted in their annual report and account what those conditions are. So I think from memory this year we've got 10 or 12 conditions which span the spectrum of what we're doing, the investment performance, financial performance, and mission delivery, third party crowding in, etc. So there's a number of elements in there that are all publicly available. The process for getting that agreed is that we within the bank will come up with a recommendation to our REMCO and our and we'll be back and forth on that with, I think, pretty robust challenge on that and what the thresholds are for that. It's, in my experience, it's a very robust process. What we then do is we then go to our shareholder team to seek their support to then take it to the ministers for their sign-off ultimately. So okay. That's the process.
Okay, and ultimately Scottish ministers sign this up?
Ultimately.
Okay, yes. Thank you. One other question, I'll come to Scottish Enterprise in a minute. One more question for SNB. I noticed that you've spent on a PR firm, according to the accounts, in 23-24, the last financial year, £96,000 on contracting with a PR firm. What's that for?
So one of the things that as a business, and fairly new business, but also a business in a complicated financial ecosystem, is that we feel that we need to get our message out and our communications out to all elements of the financial ecosystem that makes to remove confusion and to tell our story ultimately. As a young bank, if you were, as I was going through my interview process, you could go online and do Googles and you could see lots of commentary from people who were guessing what the bank did, what they didn't do, what their mission should be, what it wasn't. So there was a lot of that, and I think we have to get out there and tell our story about who we are, what we're not, what we're doing, what our focus areas are, and so on and so forth. I think that's beneficial for a number of reasons. One, it's beneficial in making it clear to potential investee companies what we do, so that if we get an inquiry, we're getting an inquiry that's makes sense and it's reasonable. It also makes it very clear to stakeholders of all in all spheres of life, whether it be parliamentary or business or media, whatever, just this is who the bank are. It's also very important, in my opinion, as we're doing third-party capital strategy, that the message that is out there about what we do is consistent, and it also reflects the reality of what we do, and it's informed. We're also doing social media like Adrian's doing. We've got some 13,000 followers on LinkedIn now, so we use multiple sources. But I think it's important that we get the message about who the bank is out in a consistent way when there's sometimes a bit of confusion.
Okay, thank you. And one question I made to Scottish Enterprise. Your accounts for 23-24 show a significant change in emphasis in spending priorities, with a shift away from business growth towards innovation and investment. Now, scaling up businesses is one of the key objectives of NSET. So why has there been this shift in priorities, or is that simply driven by the reduction in your budget?
Yeah, I think that may just be language there. So that was what I was saying earlier about sort of incremental growth rather than transformative growth, which is transformation is in NSET, it's the T in NSET, and that's what we're very focused on. And as I say, I think that's where a national agency should be focused. So business growth, that's our purpose. Our purpose is defined as helping companies to innovate and scale with the outcome of transforming the economy. So business growth is fundamentally important to us. But where we should be getting involved is those stages of business growth that are transformative. So capital investments, supporting innovation where there's risks that the project would not happen had it not been for our kind of support. Export support is transformative.
Douglas talked about our support for export programmes. Very often we'll take a business, one to Bio in Boston last year, 40 million additional sales for the companies that went on that trip as a result of it. So quite a few of the things that we do through, and we've traditionally done, like export support, like innovation support, are fundamentally important to us. It's where we're setting the bar around the kind of projects that we should be supporting that's changed fundamentally.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Willie Coffey.
Very much, convener, and good morning to everybody. I wonder if I could first ask a question to Scottish Enterprise colleagues. It's about performance and targets that you've included in your own annual report. Adrian, if you were to replicate your performance, your outturn on a number of indicators there, you would have already have met the targets that you've set for yourself for the current year that we're in. The question is, could you perhaps have been a little bit more ambitious? I mean, this is a good story, let me say. This is really good performance. But in getting that good performance, did you consider stretching the targets for the following year a little bit?
So this is what we achieved in the last financial year. And there were some record achievements. Well, I cast my mind back to the discussion we had with our board at the beginning of that year, and our board's challenge back to the executive team was they felt we might be being too ambitious, given the increases. And I think when you look at the record job figures, so the 16,500 jobs is a record performance. The capital investment, so to put that in context, over the last 5 years, we've supported £3.8 billion of capital investment projects. Last year, that was £1.9 billion. So it just shows you, you know, in that 1 year, what you know, that would tend to be what we would do over 3 or 4 years. I don't think we could have foreseen some of that. I think it's important to say there are some very lumpy capital projects in there. Energy transition projects tend to be very capital intensive. So it's really important that these projects are realised. But I don't think we should have set ourselves the target of being any more ambitious, because we couldn't have foreseen that level of performance coming through.
Okay.
I mean, I'm bound to say that. I mean, it's straight up. That was the conversation. Our board were concerned that we might not be able to hit some of those. And there were times in the year, actually, where we were concerned that we might not be fixing those targets, and it did focus the mind. So I think they fulfilled the purpose of having those stretch objectives.
Okay, good answer. Douglas, did you want to add a wee bit to that there?
If I could come in, Willie. We actually did stretch the targets upper range in the current year for 5 out of the 6. The one that we kept static was the growth investment related one, just because of the difficulties of the budget we've talked about, and also the market. But in doing that, we recognised that, as Adrian said, there were some significant contributors which you can't always replicate. So we recognised that, and we took that decision to set that ambition. It's partly because we want to maintain this momentum in building pipeline, good quality transformative projects, and we think we can make the budget, as Adrian has said before. We're constantly raising the bar in terms of what we will support, and therefore that should feed through in terms of some of the results. But it comes with its challenges.
Okay. Adrian, did you want to?
Thank you. Just a quick point, a really important point, though, is that many of our customers and our staff across the world listen in to this discussion, and they will hear a lot about the challenges around budgets. It's really important that we keep the message that we are looking for transformative projects, and that some of these challenges don't lower our ambition. So I just want to say that for the sake of our people across the world that are looking for these projects, the message from us is very, very keep delivering those projects, and we will find a way to navigate through the budgetary challenges. We're raising our ambition, not lowering.
Okay, that's brilliant. I've got a few other questions I'd like to ask probably both of you. We noted at the committee previously that HIE had seemed to be scaling back a wee bit on their assessment and evaluation activity. Now, there's been a little bit of discussion around the table this morning. Could you just confirm that you don't have any intention to do that, that you will thoroughly report and evaluate the impact and assessment of your achievements and so on?
Yeah. If I understand, I wasn't aware of what Hai said, so if you excuse me for, hopefully I interpret your question correctly. So when we look at our impact, we measure it on a company by company or investment by investment basis, and we make it a condition of our investment to the company reports that back to us, and we've got a central database that gathers all that, and we're committed to doing that. As I mentioned earlier in an earlier question, we see impact as being critical to what we do. It's impact and it's commercial, both, and therefore we have no intent to ever cut back on that. And we're very transparent in reporting on that. In fact, we're very transparent on what our objectives are for impact as well, which is quite unusual for an investor.
Same for Scottish Gender Plus, Adrian.
Yeah.
Thanks very much. Wearing my parochial hat slightly, I mean, you both mentioned some really impressive figures at the outset. Al, you were saying £650 million invested, 37 businesses. Adrian, you said 80,000 jobs delivered, 26,000 jobs in the investment pipeline coming along. If I were to come along and ask you as a Ayrshire MSP or indeed any of our colleagues, how can we see where the benefit of all of this is going to our particular parts of Scotland? Do you do that? I'm not asking you for it now, but could we see as members that that impact and those benefits are being spread around Scotland so that all the communities in Scotland will benefit from this activity?
Yeah, we have that impact by region. Ayrshire, for example, XLCC at Hunterston is a big contributor to those. That's 800 jobs, almost £1 billion capital investment. So there are some very chunky projects. And if I could go round Ayrshire and I could tell you, DSM, you know, there's many, many projects that we've supported there, and many in the pipeline also. So we can give you that regional picture, and I think we could tell that regional story a bit better, frankly, and we're working on that.
That's excellent. And Al, is there any kind of regional dimension to your reporting as well?
Yeah, so we were set up to make sure that we focus on all the regions of Scotland, and that is our mantra. We are still young, so we've only got to 24 of the 32 so far, but our ambition is to get to all 32 in due course. I don't have any yet in Ayrshire, but that's not because of lack of trying.
Okay. My last question for you is about artificial intelligence and the ability to understand and engage with developments in that area. Neither of you have a clear strategic mention of AI, its risks and opportunities, perhaps, not only for within your organisation, but possible developments externally. Could you say just a little bit whether you're aware of the risks and opportunities provided by AI and what you might be planning to do in the years to come?
Yes, and you will see more of that in what we produce in the future. We had a very good discussion about this with our board just after the summer there. There's aspects of how we deliver on our services. And I know Hai and Sozi mentioned this a couple of weeks ago. The co-pilot, we're all involved in the pilot of co-pilot, if you like, in terms of how we deliver. But there's also some areas that our staff sort of see as getting in the way of us working with our customers that we can take away through the use of artificial intelligence. We've just developed a digital and data strategy. That's what went to our board, and we'll be publishing that very shortly, and they'll have much more to say on how we utilise AI. It's also an opportunity for the economy, and we are working through our innovation advisors with companies on the opportunities for AI specifically and how they can utilise AI. And in particular, I guess some of the embedded AI that's going to be in, you know, Office and some of these products that companies are already using. And it is also an opportunity for inward investment. So there's actually a very strong pipeline of AI companies, mainly from the US, who are very interested in Scotland. They see the skill set that we have here, the capabilities, engineering, software, has been really strong. A company called Launchpad, for example, what they manufacture is an AI, doesn't do it justice, but a box that can actually manufacture pretty much anything, including large structures for the offshore wind sector, for example. Significant amounts of private sector funding, and they see Scotland. Actually, interesting story there is that they weren't considering Scotland, and that referral came through one of our trade envoys in California, a personal contact he had that put Scotland on the map, and as soon as we were in, then we were able to convince them that Scotland was the optimal location. So I make that point that extended network we have across the world is very tuned into the AI opportunity and is bringing opportunities our way as well. So it's really important. You will see more to come from us on that. As a sector in itself, yes, but also just as something that cuts right across the economy.
Excellent. Al, any engagement with AI?
Yes, pick up some of Adrian's points. So one of the things that I'll look at it both within SNB and then what we're doing in investment, if I can. So within SNB, we recognise that this is a potential productivity tool to help us do our job a bit better. We are considering how we might do some of our due diligence better, linking into Companies House and other data sources to help speed up that process. So it doesn't mean that you'll have AI making the decisions, but it'll help make the gathering of the information you need a bit more efficient. So that's something we're considering, but what we want to do, and I put my risk hat on here, is I want to make sure that we put the boundaries around that in terms of data going out, make sure that we can't be hacked, all those things that you'd expect from a risk perspective. So we're working our way through that. The other thing is we're noting is that what I'll call the youngsters, and I'm saying that with grey hair, is they're all aware of using these types of tools to help them do their studying and their jobs, and so therefore it's a language they know, and I think we need to help facilitate that in a safe way. So we're actively looking at that, and Copilot is one of the tools that we're looking at. With respect to investments, because this is a relatively new area, we're not seeing a lot of investments. There is an element that we have to be guarded against of what I call AI washing. That there are some people saying, oh, well, we're AI, therefore we deserve a higher valuation. Put that to one side as a thing that one must be aware of when we're making an investment. We have actually just yesterday announced our first AI-related investment. It was actually based up in Aberdeen. It was called Leap AI. And where this is quite interesting is it's focused on the food and beverage area, which is an area where they have skill shortages, and it will help those companies actually do a bit more of their picking and sorting and putting the vegetables in the right place using a computer to do it that can recognise whether something's an avocado or a potato or whatever. You know. I'm simplifying it, for effect. But that's our first investment. We made it yesterday, £3.5 million investment in an Aberdeen company to support that. And in that one, we crowded in, I think, about £4 million of third-party capital as well at the same time.
That's really interesting to you. You remind me of a kind of AI development in the NHS that dispenses medicines as well. Mm. It's done very much in that fashion too. But thank you very much for your example there. Thank you.
Thank you. Just a couple of questions before we finish. There's been wide discussion this morning about financial transactions. But my understanding of financial transactions are they are consequences of UK government spending. And it was the former First Minister who initially described them as a con before it was seen as a solution to funding the Scottish National Investment Bank. The Scottish Government have said that they have an assumption there'll be no further financial transactions. So I'll come back to the Scottish National Investment Bank. I suppose the £2 billion is dependent on financial transactions, and the Scottish Government are saying they're assuming there will be no further financial transactions. What discussions are you having with them about alternatives, and how are you confident about the £2 billion given the assumption that they are making?
So I think there are two elements to this that we're having conversations. One is with making sure that our case is made from SG to UKG to make sure that they think about in the next budget how can they help facilitate this. So that's one conversation, and making the point about the benefits that we bring. The other element, of course, is I guess it's up to ministers to decide how to allocate their budgets generally, and clearly we're making the point that we get a multiplier effect on the money we spend. It's a benefit that should be considered alongside other investment or other spending decisions as well. So we think it's a very important case that needs to be made.
And the same question to Scottish Enterprise about the assumption there'll be no further financial transactions. It plays a significant part of your funding. There is options for the Scottish Government to transfer funds from resource to capital budgets. Is that something that you would be asking them to do, and what discussions are you having about alternative funding?
Well, so our investment activities existed before financial transactions existed, and they were funded out of our regular capital budget, and we always have we've actually utilised 10 million of our capital funding to fund investments. The advantage of that is that rather than financial transactions being paid back to the source of the financial transactions, the UK government, if we do it from our regular capital budget, we keep all of the returns from that that we can reinvest. So there are options open to us there to use the regular capital budget to fund our investments and to keep all of the returns. So we strongly make the case that this is not a budget line, this is not a spend line, this is an investment line, and it pays back down the line. And we've got a lot of evidence now to show not just the financial returns, which are very significant. So you know, over £500 million of income we've generated from those funds. There have been losses, but they're £170 million. They're a small part of the returns, but they've also created over 4,500 jobs. And they've also, I mean, one of the things about, you know, having been patient and changing the economy over time is that it's easy to forget that 20 years ago, the early stage investment market looked very, very different in Scotland, and that the existence of these funds have brought a lot of new investors to the country. So this is the case that we put forward. Ultimately, the options will be, the decisions will be with ministers. We're doing our bit in terms of looking for other sources of funding, both in Scotland and internationally, now that we do have a very established and successful model that we believe compares extremely well with private sector investment models as well. So there might well be the opportunity for us to leverage in other funds at the fund level to allow us to continue that. So we're trying to keep all options open. But the points that have been made this morning about its importance to the economy are I think, very well made, and that we need to find a way to keep those investments going. We need to find a way to make that happen. Those are the discussions that were happening at the moment.
OK, thank you. And just finally, a question for Scottish National Investment Bank. When you were here in June last year, we had a discussion about the finance that was provided to Circularity Scotland. As part of that, you said you were reviewing the decision-making process. I'm just wondering if that process is complete, and is there any lessons that were learned through that?
Thank you. As I said at the time, I had looked at the time through all of the investment decision papers, the full audit trail of all of the factors that were taken into account in that process, and I did that through the lens of a new person coming in with experience in the investment industry as a chief investment officer at some of the largest institutions in the country. So I did it with on the basis of personal experience. I looked through all those investment decision papers, and I've contented myself that all of the right steps were taken, and that they were taken with full operational independence of the investments committees of the bank, which I think was one of the challenges that we faced. In terms of the actual underwriting process, as I said, it's absolutely market standard. It's financial due diligence, operational due diligence, management due diligence, managed opportunity, all those elements at the time. The political environment at the time, we had various governments globally at the time. We're talking about circular deposit schemes, and we had support from various governments in this country for that direction of travel. And so I think at the time the decision was taken, I think it was a sound decision. But that was the conclusion I came to.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. That brings us to the end of today's session. I thank the witnesses for attending this morning, and I move us into private session.